At this time, let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 12 through 18. We're taking a little break from our series on 1 Timothy because I believe that this, I just wanted to share something very fundamental for our growth as Christians. So we will take a look at this passage today. This is God's word. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened, for to this day, when they read the Old Covenant, that same veil remains unlifted because only through Christ is it taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now, the Lord is a spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Amen. Do you feel like you are progressing in your Christian life, growing in your work of faith, labor of love, and steadfastness of hope? I hope that is the case, and if that is the case, what do you think you are doing right? If not, why not? Does any of you feel like you are trying your best, but God is not helping you? Today, based on today's passage, I'd like to share with you how we can grow in our Christian life. It is by beholding the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. I dare say that even if you think you are changing and growing, if you are not doing what Paul is saying here, you are doing it wrong. So I hope we could give our careful attention to Paul's words in this passage. As we do so, I hope you can see that God is displaying before you the glory of Jesus Christ through this message, as poor and inadequate as it may be. I urge you at this time to be wholly present. Don't wait for another time that's more convenient for you. Don't wait for God to speak to you in other ways that are more palatable to you. You are here to worship God, aren't you? Didn't you not come to hear what God had to say to you? Someone said, procrastination is the arrogant assumption that God owes you another chance to do tomorrow what he gave you the chance to do today. Procrastination is the arrogant assumption that God owes you another chance to do tomorrow what he gave you the chance to do today. There is no procrastination more dangerous and deadly than the spiritual procrastination of not responding to God when he speaks to you. But I assure you that if you prayerfully pay attention to the word of God, even now, God will show you his glory and transform you even today and set you on a path to greater glory. The first thing I'd like us to notice is that we are destined for glory. Paul says in verse 18, and we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. Notice what Paul says, and we all, it is not just special and extra faithful Christians that are destined for glory. We all are destined for glory. Not just Paul and those like him, but also the thief on the cross and those like him. So we know that it is not because there is anything special about any of us. It is only because our Lord Jesus Christ is great. and therefore the salvation he gives is great. So great is his salvation that not only does he deliver us from the torments of hell, but he also bestows on us exceeding glory. This was God's design from the very beginning when he created man in his own image. Whatever the image of God may signify, it cannot exclude the idea of glory. Can we think of God without any idea of glory? What was the one thing that Moses desired more than anything? To behold God's glory. He said, God, show me your glory. Exodus 33:18. When the tabernacle where God was supposed to dwell among his people was constructed and erected, what did God do? He filled it with the glory of the Lord. Exodus 40:34. How did the seraphim in heaven praise God in Isaiah's vision? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. The whole earth is full of his glory. Isaiah 6:3. We cannot think of the image of God, therefore, without the idea of glory. We don't know what Adam and Eve looked like before the fall. I'm not suggesting that some kind of light emanated from them. But there must have been a subtle but powerful glory which radiates from a sinless and righteous soul full of untainted love and joy and peace. But of course, the image of God was marred and lost as a result of the fall. Instead of the original glory of the image of God, shame now covered the fallen pair and all their descendants. Whatever glory we see in people and their accomplishments after the fall is but a faded photo of the pre-fall glory of the image of God. Redemption then is the restoration and perfection of the image of God in man. That is what is being accomplished in believers. As Paul describes in verse 18, and we all being transformed into the are being transformed into the same image from one glory to another. The moment you place your faith in Jesus Christ, in fact, the moment God causes you to be born again by the Spirit of Christ, your transformation begins from the shameful image of sin to the glorious image of God. And this transformation process will not stop until you are glorified in heaven on the day of resurrection. On that day, you will be perfected as the image of God and share in the ineffable glory of God as much as it is humanly possible. It may be even that our glory, our heavenly glory, will surpass the glory of the angels in heaven. Yes, we have been made a little lower than the heavenly beings, Psalm 8:5. The heavenly angels are glorious beings, so glorious that when John saw an angel, he felt compelled to fall at his feet to worship him, Revelation 19:10. But you see, God redeemed us, and by redeeming us, he adopted us as his beloved children in his beloved Son. The angels in heaven are but ministering spirits, Hebrews 1:14. Though they are at times called sons of God, it was merely by virtue of God's creation, not by adoption through our union with God's eternal Son. Even if we may not surpass the glory of their appearance, since they are pure spirits, we will certainly surpass them in the glory of honor and privilege as God's children. So it is not surprising that we are being transformed from one degree of glory to another. At the foundational level, this is redemptive historical in scope. The scope covered by the phrase from one degree of glory to another is not limited to the lifetime of the Christian in this world, but it extends to the two ages, the present age and the age to come. It ultimately refers to the transformation from the glory of the Christian in the present age to the glory of the Christian in the age to come. This is one of the reasons that Paul describes the Lord, Jesus Christ, and identifies him with the Spirit. Now the Lord, Jesus Christ, is the Spirit, verse 17. And he also speaks of the Lord who is the Spirit, verse 18. Paul is not saying that the Lord and the Spirit are the same in their ontological identity, in their being, their personhood. They are two distinct persons in the Trinity, although they share the same essence. But here, Paul is talking about their functional identity. This is why Jesus could say, at the very time he was ascending to heaven after giving the Great Commission, "And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." How could he say that when he was about to leave the disciples, that at the very time he said, "I would be with you to the end of the age"? It is because he was about to send the Holy Spirit, who is now the Spirit of the Lord. Verse 17. So as the Holy Spirit can be called the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, Jesus can be called the Spirit in verses 17 and 18. Similarly, Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:45 said, "The first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit," referring to Jesus Christ. The description of Jesus as the Spirit or a life-giving Spirit emphasizes the glorified status of Jesus in heaven, which is a spiritual realm. Heaven is a spiritual realm. Jesus being described as a spirit emphasizes that now he belongs to that spiritual realm. So our resurrection body is described as a spiritual body. Because it is a body designed to dwell in heaven, which is the realm of the Spirit. But the expression from one degree of glory to another also refers to the transformation throughout our lifetime in this world. Paul says we are being transformed from one degree of glory to another. It is happening now and will continue throughout our lives until it is consummated at the second coming of Jesus Christ. This doesn't mean that our faces will shine as Moses' face did. For now, it means that we will be more and more conformed to the image of Jesus Christ in character. This will surely be accompanied by some visible changes, of course. We know how different people look when they're joyous and when they are distressed. So as we become more and more conformed to the image of Christ, even our facial appearances will be transformed. Then how do we get transformed from glory to glory? Paul's answer is very simple. It is by beholding the glory of Christ. But to do that, we must first have our veil removed, which prevents us from seeing Christ. Paul speaks of the veil with which Moses covered his face because his face shone with glory whenever he communed with God. But it was only symbolic of the internal veil which blinds us. But their minds were hardened, verse 14. I believe that this internal veil is the spiritual death of sinners. Ephesians 2:1, "You are dead in the trespasses and sins." What is tricky about our spirits is that they are immortal. They are not like our body, mortal bodies that stop functioning when we die. Our spirits never stop functioning, whether dead or alive, in a spiritual sense. They just function differently. When our spirits are alive, we are alive to the things of God, but dead to the things of sin. The things of God bring joy and thrill to our hearts. Only the things of God can thrill our souls with true joy. By the things of God, I do not mean just the ordinary means of grace, the Word of God, the sacraments, and prayer, or just religious things that you do in church ministries. I mean everything that is seen through the eyes of faith. These are all things of God. When your spiritual eyes are open, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims His handiwork. Psalm 19:1. When your spiritual eyes are open, you see the mountains and the hills break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field clap their hands. Isaiah 55:12. When your eyes are open, we see the providential hand of God constantly and faithfully tending to the whole universe with His wisdom, goodness, and righteousness. He does so. You are able to see that not only out there in the world, but you could see the constant care of God for you and your life. So we can delight not only in God's creation and providence, but we can also delight in God's salvation. The opposite is true when our spirits are dead. When our spirits are dead, we are dead to the things of God, but alive, very much alive to the things of sin. The things of God don't make any sense to us, making us yawn in boredom. The things of God seem foolish and even detestable to us. But the things of sin make our hearts beat fast with excitement and make our mouths salivate over the anticipated guilty pleasures. We'd rather do anything than think about and do the things of God. With a veil of spiritual death over our eyes, we don't see the futility and transience of worldly pleasures without God. Nor do we see the tragic end of all our sinful pursuits is not death, but something far worse awaiting us beyond the grave. Worst of all, we fail to see the goodness of God in the gospel of Jesus Christ, opposing this good news as if it would ruin us instead of saving us. Yes, the gospel will ruin our lives as we know it, for sure. But it will do so only to build us up again on the solid foundation of Jesus Christ, so that we can withstand the storm of God's divine judgment against our sins. So we can be built up as God's living temple, full of glory and beauty. But you see, such prospect holds no attraction to those that are dead in their trespasses and sins. They would rather build their own lives on the shifting sand of fortune and luck, and forage through the trash dump in the hope of finding something valuable. What a sad existence. Paul tells us that the veil of our spiritual death is removed only through Christ, verse 14. It is only when God makes us alive together with Christ, Ephesians 2:5, that the veil of spiritual death can be removed. Only when we are made alive with Christ can we begin to see. But what is it that we are made to see? The glory of our Lord Jesus Christ as He is revealed in the Scriptures, verse 18. The veil is removed through Christ so that we can behold the glory of Christ. We are made alive together with Christ so that we can go on living a new life in Christ, being transformed from glory to glory. Christ is not just the means to an end. He is both the end, the means and the end. Means and the end. He is all in all. He is the Alpha and the Omega. We can be transformed from glory to glory after our veil is removed, because finally we can behold the glory of the Lord. It is by beholding the glory of the Lord that we are transformed from glory to glory. Throughout the New Testament, when this title Lord is used of Jesus, it signifies his identity as Yahweh, the covenant name of God, which the Jews do not pronounce for fear of breaking the third commandment not to take God's name in vain. And they replace that name with Adonai, which means my Lord. So when the disciples referred to Jesus as the Lord, they were confessing that he was none other than Yahweh himself. Even though his divine nature was veiled by his human body, there were undeniable glimpses of his divine glory throughout his earthly ministry. He claimed his deity when he told the Jews, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am," John 8:58. He spoke of his eternal existence when he said, "Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad," John 8:56. Maybe Jesus was referring to the ram that was caught in the thicket which was offered as a sacrifice in place of Isaac at Mount Moriah, Genesis 22:13. Jesus also said, Isaiah said these things because he saw the Messiah's glory and spoke of him, John 12:41. Jesus was referring to the time Isaiah saw the vision of God's heavenly council, Isaiah 6, after which he said what Jesus quoted earlier. Of course, we cannot forget about the memorable description of the suffering servant of the Lord in Isaiah 53, who would be pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities, chastised for our peace, and wounded for our healing. But Jesus did not simply make these claims. He demonstrated the truth of his claims. Do you remember? Demons shuddered at the sight of Jesus. As purely spiritual beings, they could see the true identity of Jesus as the incarnate Son of God. He healed all kinds of diseases and even raised the dead. Unlike the prophets of old, Jesus did this on his own authority without resorting to prayer. And when he did pray, he did so to demonstrate his unique sonship to God as God's eternal only begotten Son by addressing God as Father. At times, when Jesus healed, he demanded worship and rebuked those who did not worship him, such as the 9 lepers who did not return to give thanks to him after being healed. Contrast this with Elisha, who dared not take any gift from Naaman because he knew he was merely God's instrument. And interestingly, Naaman was a leper who was healed when he dipped himself in the Jordan River 7 times, according to Elisha's command. Whereas Elisha dared not take any gift from Naaman, Jesus demanded worship and thanksgiving from the 9 lepers whom he healed. And did Jesus not shock his disciples by calming the raging storm simply by rebuking it? The disciples were more terrified by what this implied about who Jesus was than the storm that almost drowned him. Consider also the I am sayings of Jesus. Many theologians have pointed, and I believe that this was precisely the point Jesus was making, that Jesus was not simply making a mundane statement about himself. He was presenting himself as Yahweh, the great I am. In commissioning Moses to deliver Israel, God said to him, "Say to the people of Israel, I am, has sent me to you." So when Jesus said, for example, "I am the good shepherd," he was not simply saying that he was one of the many good shepherds in Israel. He was declaring that he was the good shepherd of Psalm 23, in which David confessed, "The Lord, Yahweh, is my shepherd, I shall not want." David had experienced God's guidance and protection throughout his life, so he called him his shepherd. But he had no idea what his divine shepherd would do for him. As Jesus would say later, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." David might have expected the Lord to lead him through the metaphorical valley of the shadow of death with his almighty power. He did not know that his divine shepherd would do so by his voluntary weakness, not by his almighty power. By dying for him and walking through the literal valley of death in his place, so that he and you and me may walk through the valley of the shadow of death without being harmed. Paul said earlier in the letter, "For all the promises of God find their yes in him," chapter 1, verse 20. God promised a lot of great things for his people in the Old Testament: a great nation, a land flowing with milk and honey, abundant produce in the land, victory over their enemies, on and on. But you see, these were merely secondary blessings. The primary was the promise, "I will be your God and you will be my people." By binding himself to his people through a covenant, God intended to give them the greatest blessing of all: the blessing of himself as their portion and inheritance. God showed this by withholding from the priestly tribe of Levi the inheritance of the land. He said, "I am your portion and your inheritance among the people of Israel," Numbers 18:20. What blessing? What greater and better blessing can there be? All other blessings come and go. They get damaged and deteriorate. Only God, who is eternal in his being and infinite in his riches, is the gift that keeps on giving without end. Nothing he gives can compare with the glory of his person. In fact, he is all that is good, true, and beautiful. Apart from him, there cannot be any good. He is to goodness what photon is to light. Then what does it mean to behold the glory of the Lord? We have many examples of what Paul does not mean. Consider the Israelites in the wilderness. They beheld many manifestations of God's glory, more than any generation. All those miracles that they witnessed. They beheld the 10 plagues by which the Lord brought the greatest empire of the world at that time to its knees. They saw the parting of the Red Sea. They beheld water springing from the rock that Moses struck, and quails raining down from heaven for their food. Every day, they beheld the glory cloud in the form of a pillar of cloud and fire. Every day, they saw manna falling from heaven. Yet, they all perished in the wilderness for their unbelief. They saw countless miracles of God, but there was no transformation of their hearts because of their unbelief. In addition, think also of the bronze serpent Moses lifted on a pole. For their grumbling, God sent poisonous vipers to bite the Israelites. Many suffered and died. When out of desperation they called for help, the Lord showed mercy and commanded Moses to make a bronze serpent and hang it on a pole. Those who beheld it, according to God's command, were healed. But those who did not perished. But did you also know that even those that were healed ended up dying in the wilderness later? How can that be? Didn't they behold the bronze serpent because they had faith? This incident shows that there is a difference between a temporary, superficial faith and a genuine and therefore persevering faith, which alone is the saving faith. This temporary faith arises out of desperation, especially when faced with a crisis. The problem is that as it is prompted by a crisis, that faith is gone as soon as the crisis is over. In such a case, God is not what we want. We just want God to remove our problems. We look to Him as we look to a technician when our appliances break down. We don't look to Him as our Heavenly Father with whom we live day in and day out in the same house as the lover of our souls. God can and certainly does use a crisis to shake the foundation of our being and self-reliance and thus draw our desperate and longing eyes to Himself. When the eyes of our faith are thus anchored in Him, not just what He can give for us, we have received the gift of saving faith. How is your relationship with God? Do you treat Him like a technician or like your Heavenly Father? Do you seek Him when you are desperate? But as soon as your crisis is over, do you forget about Him? Do you pray to Him when you are joyous as well as when you are distressed? To behold the glory of Christ does not mean physically seeing Christ, at least for now. It is to see Christ through the eyes of faith by reading, hearing, studying, meditating, and memorizing the scriptures. For it is the scriptures that bear witness of Jesus Christ, John 5:39. The Greek word for beholding means beholding as in a mirror. This shows that we don't see His glory as clearly as we will one day see face to face, 1 Corinthians 13:12. But you see, when we see the glory of Christ as in a mirror, this will force us to behold more intently and carefully, squinting our eyes of faith to get a clearer vision. You should see me. Because now I have this multifocal contact lenses. There are certain things I could see better, some things I cannot see. And when I try to see small letters, I have to squint my eyes and move the thing like back and forth to get it into focus. But you see, when things are not as clear as they are, isn't that what you do? If you long to see it, you do everything possible, even squinting eyes, to make sense of what is out there. If all God's promises are yes and amen in Jesus Christ, shouldn't we behold Him long and hard? squinting our eyes to see how he contains himself, the fullness of all the rich blessings of God to us. How we may partake of his riches more and more from glory to glory. Should we be so easily distracted by the frivolous glories of this world, like those children who are glued to their devices even as they drive through the grandeur of Yellowstone National Park? As we conclude, I'd like to remind all of us that we are all destined for glory. This glory is much greater than any glory we can accomplish with our strength and ability. Notice the passive voice in which Paul talks of our transformation from glory to glory. And we all are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. We are the passive recipients of the transforming work of God. Paul presents our transformation as God's work of recreation, not our own moral accomplishment. God is the active one who transforms us into the image of his Son. We are the passive recipients of his active work, like a lump of clay being molded by a potter. So it is simply by beholding the glory of Christ that we are transformed, just as Moses' face shone with glory, simply through his communion with God, just as the moon shines by reflecting the light of the sun. By beholding the glory of Christ, I mean filling our minds and hearts with the biblical truth of Christ, which will lead to the transformation of our hearts and lives into the image of Jesus Christ from glory to glory. Any change we manage to make in our lives doesn't matter to God and to ourselves in the end if it is not inspired, prompted, and strengthened by our communion with Christ. Unless the house of our life is built upon the rock of Jesus Christ, it will not endure the storm of God's righteous judgment. Paul too said, the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burnt up, he will suffer loss, though himself will be saved, but only as through fire. And the foundation is Jesus Christ. Everything we do, how we live our lives, must be built upon the foundation of Christ. This is so because all the promises of God find their yes in him. Jesus Christ became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification, and redemption. Are you beholding Christ now? Do you behold Christ intently and constantly throughout your life? Because you desire Christ more than anything else. John Owen lamented, those who never had experience of any such thing, like the refreshing sense of his love or the fresh communications of consolatory communion with him, those people who never had any refreshing communion with him cannot be sensible of his absence. They never were so of his presence. Do you see what he's saying? Those of you who are complacent in your spiritual life, who can go on days and months without being immersed in the Word of God, thinking and reflecting upon Jesus Christ, and still being complacent, still thinking that you are doing okay. Not great, but you are doing okay. The tragedy of that is because you have not experienced the depth of his intimate communion with you, you are okay not to have it. You don't miss it because you've never tasted the goodness of Christ. Those who have tasted the goodness of the Lord cannot bear to lose the sight of Christ. Do you not see that your success in academics and career, your high social standing, your fame and reputation, your large checking and savings accounts, your posh retirement savings, your youth and health mean nothing if you do not behold the glory of Christ and thus are being transformed from glory to glory? Do you not see the surpassing value of the true glory that is yours when you behold Christ in faith? And do you not see that when you behold Christ, you can find the true meaning and purpose of all that you do and pursue in this world and in the age to come? If Christ is the resurrection and the life, you have no life apart from him. If so, should you not behold him like you breathe for dear life? Do you say you have tried? They say if you want to be an expert in something, you have to spend 30,000 hours of intentional, focused efforts. Have you spent 30,000 hours communing with Christ intently in a focused manner? I hope that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, convicting you, and stirring up a desire to behold Jesus Christ. Don't you want to behold him? Brothers and sisters, don't you want to behold him who beholds you with his infinite love and tenderness? Brothers and sisters, in your life, do you not need to behold someone who beholds you with his infinite love, in whose look you can find security and joy and peace that cannot be disturbed by anything else in this world? Isn't that the greatest need that you have in this weary world? With all the challenges that you are facing, with all the things that distress your life, do you not need to behold him who beholds you with his infinite love and care, and who will never turn his face away from you? I invite you to see him. He has removed the veil from your eyes so that you can behold him if you look to him in faith. And I'm certain that as you behold the glory of Christ, you and others will be able to witness your transformation from glory to glory, until that day when you shall shine like the stars of heaven in the glorious presence of God forevermore. Let us pray. O Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise for this time. Thank you, Lord, for destining us for glory. Lord, we are so easily contented with even with the shameful things of this world. So Lord, we thank you that you have spoken from heaven. And I pray, Lord, that you will break through our sinful and idle complacency and stir up in our hearts a deep longing and desire to behold Christ more than anything else. Thank you, Lord, that you watch over us. And you watch over us without neither slumbering or sleeping. I pray, Lord, that our eyes will meet. And when our eyes meet, there will be joy and peace and love inexpressible in our souls. And we will know that we are truly loved and our lives are worth living because we have something glorious and beautiful to behold. And because we are being transformed into his image from glory to glory. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.